And first, I would like to thank the organizers and the scientific committee for their invitation. I'm really pleased to be here on this special occasion. Voilà, je suis très content d'être là en cette occasion, Asia. C'est toujours un plaisir de te croiser, par exemple, à l'occasion de conférences telles que celle-ci. Ça nous donne l'occasion de discuter de mathématiques et d'autres choses. Parfois, ça donne lieu à des conversations assez animées, mais toujours passionnantes et très agréables. Donc, je suis très content d'être là en cette occasion. OK, so what I'm going to discuss today is a problem of controllability type, but not a standard controllability problem. It's a problem that is somewhat natural for flow control, when you try to understand how you can control the movement of a fluid, but it is not quite the usual notion of controllability. So perhaps to start with, I should say a few words about this notion of controllability, which makes sense for fluid models. This is the so-called Lagrangian controllability. So what you want to understand is how you can control the flow associated to a fluid. Usually when you want to consider controllability problems for a fluid, you want to control the state. Let's say you want to say that at final time, you want to manage in order to have the fluid put to rest. But this is something that concerns the fluids at final time. Here, what we would like to understand is how you can control the flow associated to the fluid. That is something that concerns the whole interval of time zero t, not only what happens at final time capital T. So to give a precise meaning of what I mean by Lagrangian controllability, I will take, for instance, the incompressible Navier-Stokes equation. So what I'm going to discuss afterwards will not concern the Navier-Stokes equation, but a simpler model. But just for the moment, let's say we have a Navier-Stokes equation. So you are in a domain omega in R2 or R3. And, well, you have this equation. So U is the velocity field, and P is the pressure field. And you see this is the conservation of momentum and the incompressibility condition. This is a very, very classical classical system, of course. And let's say that you consider the boundary control system associated to this equation. So what I mean by the boundary control system associated to it is that you single out a part of the boundary, let's say sigma, which is the control zone, the place where you can have an influence on the fluid. And what you do is that, well, you imagine that you can control what happens on sigma. You can prescribe the boundary conditions on sigma, and on the rest of the boundary, well, you cannot do anything. This is some kind of wall, and for instance, you put the usual Dirichlet boundary condition on the rest. Okay, so now you have a control system, and well, the standard problem of controllability, as you probably already all know, is try to understand what we can reach as a final state starting from a given U0. So let's say you have a given U0, an initial state of the system, a state U1, which is a target of the system, and a time T, which is a time of controllability. The standard equation of exact controllability is to say, well, given all these data, can I find a boundary control that drives the system from U0 to U1. Okay, this is a standard exact controllability problem. When you do not have exact controllability, you can, for instance, try to have information about the approximate controllability. That is when you simplify the problem a bit by saying, well, I do not want to reach U1 exactly, but I want to reach a state which is not far from U1, in a given norm and with a certain level of precision. And well, you can also state the problem in a form that does not make explicitly appear the boundary control by saying that you want to find a solution of the system that satisfies this constraint on the part of the boundary that you do not control, and so that you reach U1 or a state not far from U1. Okay, so well, this is just a detail, but you do not need necessarily to make the control appear exactly in the formulation. You can look for a solution directly rather than the boundary control. And of course, there are many, many references. These are just a few of them about what concerns the controllability of the Navier-Stokes systems. Okay, but of course there are many, many more, and well, it's still a subject with a lot of ongoing research. Okay, but this is not the type of controllability that I'm going to consider. Instead, I'm going to consider this so-called Lagrangian controllability, which is a question that has emerged a few years ago, mainly due to suggestions by Jean-Pierre Puel. And the question of Lagrangian controllability is not to control the state of the system, but to control, in some sense, the flow, and to understand how it is possible to drive a certain zone of the fluid from one place to another. So you see that this is what is described on this picture. You have your domain here, omega, and you have a zone of fluid that is in blue here, and you want to be able to act on sigma, on the control zone here, in such a way that when you follow the flow of the fluid associated to this solution with this boundary control, you make this blue zone go from here, for instance, to here. So okay, so it's some kind of it's a natural question for flow control. You can think of a pollution that you want to move from one place to another, or things like that. It's something that is natural. And what you have also in mind when studying this is also maybe the tools that you develop for that may be useful to understand how you control solids inside the fluid. And there are many, many open questions for the control of a solid inside a fluid with many different modelings. I will not get back to that, but that is also one of the hopes when you study that, to be able to obtain something on fluid solid systems. Okay, so also when you do that, you don't want your blue zone to go out of the domain in between, because it's not clear what it would mean if you let the fluid go outside, what it would mean to drive a zone from a place to another. So you put in the definition the fact that the blue zone does not leave the domain during the time interval 0t. Okay, so of course you should put conditions on the initial zone that you want to displace, and on the target zone, because, well, in general, of course, this property does not hold. So first of all, I'm considering here the Navier-Stokes, the incompressible Navier-Stokes equation. So of course, it is an incompressible model. So the initial zone and the target zone should have the same area in dimension 2 and the same volume in dimension 3. This is clearly a consequence of the incompressibility and of the fact that the zone does not leave the domain. So this is the first thing. And the second thing is that there should be no topological obstruction, meaning you will not transform a disk into an annulus, because, well, if you consider smooth solutions, you keep the topology of the zone that you transport. So with that in mind, you end up with the following definition. You say that your model satisfies the property of exact Lagrangian controllability when you consider two smooth Jordan curves or Jordan surface. Well, you could have something that is a bit more general than a Jordan surface, but let's start with this. So Jordan curve is, well, as you know, Jordan surface is an image of a sphere inside your domain. Okay, and you ask that both your Jordan curves or surface are homotopic. You can deform one onto the other. And so it lifts all the topological objections. And they surround the same area of volume. You consider the inside of the Jordan curve or the Jordan surface. You measure its volume, and it should be conserved. to be the same. And, well, you ask if that for any initial datum mu zero, well, let's say for Navier-Stokes, there exists a boundary control that drives gamma zero to gamma one in time t and leaving everything inside the domain. Okay, so that's the definition. And exactly as for the usual sense of controllability, when you do not have exact Lagrangian controllability, you may want to ask if there is a kind of approximation that holds true. And this is the definition of approximate Lagrangian controllability, which is the same thing, except that you do not want gamma zero to be sent exactly to gamma one, but approximately. So what you do is that you define the flow. So this this denotes the image of gamma zero that was of the set that was initially at time zero at the place gamma zero, and this means its location at time t. And you want, when you compare this to gamma one, for the difference to be small in CK norm, up to reparameterization, of course, because, well, you are considering curves or surfaces, so you can reparameterize everything. So this is what we call approximate Lagrangian controllability. Okay, so what I'm presenting today is not the first result in the field. Actually, the first result in the field was by my co-author Thierry Orsin from Conservatoire National des Arts et Métiers in Paris, and concerned the Burgers equation. So this was the first work in the field, and then we worked with Thierry on the Euler equation, and I will just show you what the results that we obtained for the Euler equation in a minute. And then what I'm going to discuss today is about not the Euler equation, but the stationary Stokes equation. I will get back to that. So the Euler equation corresponds to, as you know, the case of no viscosity in Navier-Stokes equation, so the so-called high Reynolds number regime. And, well, we consider mainly the same question that I raised with the incompressible Navier-Stokes equation, but with the Euler equation. So it's well, the equation is quite close. The boundary conditions in that case are not quite the same. You can impose only the normal part of the velocity to be zero on the part of the boundary that you do not control. This is due to the fact that it is a first-order equation and not a second-order equation like Navier-Stokes, but, well, it's normal. Okay, and, well, you see that if you want to obtain exact Lagrangian controllability for the Euler model, well, it does not work. And there is a simple reason for that, is that you say, okay, you suppose that you have no vorticity in the beginning. So the vorticity is the curl of the initial velocity, so it is a scalar in 2D. And in that case, well, you are in the situation where the fluid is called potential or irrotational, depending on your topology. And it happens that if you have this at the initial time, you just it's a property of the Euler equation that the vorticity, so the curl of the velocity, will stay equal to zero near the zone that you try to control. This is a consequence of the fact that the zone that you try to, whose flow you try to control, does not leave the domain. And it is a standard property of the 2D Euler equation that the vorticity is transported by the velocity field. And if you put that together, you end up with the fact that near gamma zero and near the transported place of gamma zero, you have always a velocity field that is a gradient of a harmonic field. You can show that it's elementary. And if you have that, you have a vector field that transports your zone gamma zero that is for all time real analytic. And if it is for all time real analytic, it propagates real analyticity. And this is sufficient to prove that you have not exact Lagrangian controllability. You start from gamma zero real analytic, you want to reach gamma one that is smooth, but not real analytic, you have no way to obtain that. Okay, so it's just a simple argument in this case, because we chose to put everything in the context of C-infinite curves gamma one. Okay, but, well, this is an argument to say, well, we don't have exact Lagrangian controllability in the general case, but we can reach approximate Lagrangian controllability. So for the 2D Euler equation, that's what we obtained with Thierry Orsin. You have gamma zero and gamma one that are, as before, homotopic and that enclose the same area. You have some mu zero that is smooth. And you can find a boundary control, or you can find a solution that makes gamma zero stay inside domain for all time, and that makes it reach approximately gamma one with as high precision as you want. You can have to take k here that is as large as you want, and epsilon as small as you want. Okay, so this is what we obtained for the 2D Euler, and for the 3D Euler, we have something that is really close. There are two differences. First, we simplified a bit the topological assumption. So we have a stronger assumption when we suppose that our surfaces are contractible, which is stronger than homotopic, of course. And the other thing is that we do not obtain this for all time, but we say that there exists a time, capital T, such that we can reach approximately gamma 1 from gamma 0. And when we say there exists a time, capital T, we want to say that there exists a time small enough, not large enough, but small enough. So it seems strange to say, it's easier to control for a short time than for a long time, but we are considering 3D Euler, so we do not know if the solution stays smooth or not. It's still a huge open problem to know if there is a finite time singularities for solution of 3D Euler or not, which is not the case for 2D. So here what we do is that we can control for small time before any possible blow-up of the equation. So that's why we say that there exists a time. It's just to prevent blow-up. It's not... It should be an arbitrary time, and, we have this blow-up problem. Okay, so this is what is known for the 3D Euler equation, and now let's go back to the problem that I'm discussing today. So what I'm considering today is not Euler equation, and it's not Navier-Stokes. It is Stokes equation, and not the evolutionary Stokes equation, but the stationary Stokes equation. And this is something standard model for the so-called low Reynolds number regime. That is for when the fluid is very, very viscous. In that case, you let nu go to infinity and you end up more or less with this system. So this system is stationary, but for all time you can define this. And if you can define something for this for all time, you can of course define a flow, and you can define the problem of Lagrangian controllability as it was defined in the case of the Navier-Stokes system. So this is what we are considering here. So you have omega, a bounded smooth domain in dimension 2 or 3. You consider the stationary Stokes equation. So the equation only consider derivatives with respect to the x variable, but not derivative with respect to time. However, we are concerned with solutions which depend on time and which are regular. Okay, we have a zone on the boundary where we do not control d omega without sigma, and a zone where we control with that is sigma. So, in that case, the usual problem of controllability would not make much sense. I mean, it's not an evolution problem, so it's not clear what we would like to say by going from U0 to U1. But when you try to consider the flow associated to this, it makes perfect sense. So that is what we are going to consider. We want to make a zone delimited by gamma zero go to a target delimited by gamma one. And I must say that there are several results about controllability which are considering this model, in particular in the context of microswimmers. So these are these results by Alou, Giraldi, De Simone, and Loéac Munier, where they consider, they try to model very small swimmers, so in a regime that is really the regime of Stokes' system. and try to understand how, by the deformation of your small swimmer, they can the swimmer can well actually swim. Okay, so well, it is the same kind of context. Okay, so I showed you an objection in the case of Euler equation, and basically the same an objection to exact Lagrangian controllability, and this was an objection that relied on analyticity. Well, basically the same objection applies here. It is even in some sense simpler. The solutions of the Stokes equation, when there is no right-hand side, are real analytic. So, well, you can use the same argument to say, okay, if I use this, if I consider this system, for all time, I have a U that is analytic with respect to the X variable. So the corresponding flow propagates the analyticity, and you cannot go from any gamma zero to any gamma one. And so we consider approximate Lagrangian controllability. So, so what we obtained is these two results, one in 2D, one 3D, more or less they are the same results. There is a small difference with topology, but well, it's not very, very important. And well, it looks a lot like the results that we obtained for the Euler equation. That is to say, you consider two curves in omega that are homotopic, if you do not want to have a topological objection. They enclose the same area. You don't want to have you don't want to have the objection due to the incompressibility of the model. And then, if you have that, so of course it is not an evolution problem. So you do have no initial initial data. Well, you could put an initial data, but it's not so important as for evolution problems. But okay. And well, given this and the time and epsilon and so on, you can find a solution, which depends on time, but which for each time is a solution of the stationary Stokes equation, which satisfies the constraints and which drives gamma zero to gamma one, approximately, by staying inside the domain. Okay, so this is what we obtain in the 2D case, and in the 3D case, it's almost the same, except that we have this a bit stronger assumption from the topological viewpoint, which are that gamma zero and gamma one are contractible. You can contract them to a point which is a bit stronger than the fact that they are homotopic. But well, we could relax a bit this condition by in fact saying that gamma zero and gamma one are isotopic, but well, I'm not going into the details for that. Okay, so these are the two results of Lagrangian controllability that we obtained for our model, which is stationary Stokes. And it happens that, well, this question of Lagrangian controllability is connected to some kind of other problem, which is not exactly a problem of a control theory, but, well, you can see it with the eyes of people working in control theory, but at the beginning it was clearly not in this field. And what it is connected with is a problem of approximation, a very classical problem of approximation. And the origins of the problem of approximation are Runge's theorem, which is, as you know, a standard theorem of holomorphic approximation, of approximation of holomorphic functions by rational functions. And, well, you have actually a whole field of the analysis which is connected to that, not only holomorphic approximation, but also so-called harmonic approximation. And, we obtain a result that looks a bit like these results in this field. So first, let me perhaps recall what are the classical results in the field. So you have this very important theorem by Runge, which tells you that if you have a holomorphic function defined in the neighborhood of some compact set in the complex plane, you can approximate this holomorphic function on the compact as accurately as you want, and by rational functions. The only thing that you have to be sure about is that you can put a pole of your rational function in each connected component of C less than sigma on the complement of the complement of the compact set in C. So it means that if there are holes inside the compact, you have to be able to put a pole inside these holes. Okay? So this is the classical theorem of Runge. And there have been many developments of this theorem after Runge, and in particular this famous result by Mergelian, which, by the way, you can find in Walter Rudin's textbook on complex analysis. It is a classical result, even if it's not so old. I mean, it's 1952, I think, Mergelian's theorem, while Runge is 1885. So it looks really close, but in fact, it takes a lot of work to obtain Mergelian. And what Mergelian says is that you can have you take a compact set. So in this case, there is no, the complement of K is connected, meaning there is no hole in K. But this is perhaps not the most striking fact. The striking fact is that the fact that you do not suppose at the beginning to have a holomorphic function defined in a neighborhood of K, but only a function that is continuous on K and holomorphic in the inside of K. And with that, you can also obtain a good approximation of your holomorphic function. So this kind of results for holomorphic approximation, they have led to many generalization or extensions, I should say, to harmonic approximations. That is harmonic, that is approximations, not by a holomorphic function, but approximations by harmonic functions. And in particular, there is this result by Walsh. So actually, the statement that I am putting here is not the original statement by Walsh, but a variant by Gardiner. Gardiner has written a book on the whole subject of harmonic approximation. And well, this comes from his book. So the result of Walsh, I think it's 1929. And the book of Gardiner, it's in the 80s. Okay, so the way Gardiner writes it is a bit complicated, but actually it's simple. You consider an open set in Rn, so we are not in the complex plane, but in Rn, and you have a compact set in Rn. And there is this condition that you consider the Alexandrov compactification of O. So, well, it looks difficult, but actually it's a fancy way, this assumption, to say that O meets all the connected components of Rn minus K. Okay, because, well, the Alexandrov compactification consists in adding a point that connects all the connected components of O, which is a point at infinity. And basically, what you say about this is that you do not add another connected component of the complementary by removing K. So more or less, it says, well, not more or less, exactly, it says that there is a part of O in each connected component of Rn minus K. And in that case, you start from a harmonic function defined on the neighborhood of K, and you can approximate it by a harmonic function defined on O. So there is a particular case of that, is that when K has no hole, K is a ball, for instance, and you consider a harmonic function defined on the neighborhood of this ball, then you can obtain an approximation by a harmonic function, and you can ask that the singularity in this case is at infinity, so you can approximate this harmonic function by harmonic polynomials. And this is what originally Walsh proved in 1929. So, and this is the kind of tools that we used for to control the Euler equation, to obtain Lagrangian controllability results for the Euler equation. So now that we wanted to obtain something in the viscous framework, we tried to obtain an equivalent of this theorem by Walsh in the case of Stokes system, of the stationary Stokes system. So this is what we obtained, and this is what we use to prove the results that I mentioned before. So you consider, so it is an equivalent of the Runge-Walsh theorem, but actually it is a weak equivalent. It's not as strong as the Walsh theorem. So you consider a compact set in dimension 2 and 3, and you consider a compact K. This is the place where you want to have your approximation. you consider an open set new, that is the place where you have originally, this is a neighborhood of K, where originally you have a solution of your Stokes system. And you have omega, which is a larger open set on which you want to define your approximations. So typically, we would like to have omega that is equal to Rn, at least when there is no topological obstruction. But, well, this is where our result is a bit weaker than Walsh. We consider only omega a bounded set. So, okay, we will obtain approximations of our solution defined on a way larger set, but not on the whole plane, just on omega as large as we want. Okay, and then it's the same. You start from a solution of Stokes defined on U, and you approximate it on the compact K by a solution that is defined on omega, or if you prefer, defined everywhere, but satisfies the equation only in omega. It makes no difference. Okay, so this is a kind of extension of Walsh theorem, but in the case of solution of stationary Stokes, approximation theorem. Okay, so now I will start first with saying a few words about how we prove this result of approximation, this result, this Walsh type result for the Stokes equation. And then, in a second time, I will explain how we use it to obtain the so-called Lagrangian controllability. And, well, it turns out that the proof the proof that we found for this kind of weak Walsh theorem for Stokes equation uses the original result of Walsh. I mean, we rely on harmonic approximation to obtain approximation for the stationary Stokes system. So first, there is a simple remark that says, okay, we start from a compact set K. This is a place where we want to have the approximation. We start also from an open set nu. This is the open set where the function is defined on the beginning. And then there is this set omega, which is the place where we want the approximations to live. Okay, so K is a compact set, and V and omega are just general open sets. And as you know, a compact set can be very, very complicated. It can be, I don't know, a Cantor set or something like that. An open set also can be complicated. It can be the complement of a Cantor set, etc. So it's not very easy to work with such general, domains when you want to have these Stokes equation everywhere. So a first step consists in simplifying the geometric situation. I mean, you want to have an approximation of K. If you can have an approximation on a slightly larger set, slightly larger compact set, well, you do a better job, so it's okay. In the same way, the neighborhood V is on which the original function is defined is a general open set. If you reduce it a bit, you prove a stronger statement. And omega is also a set where you want everything to be to live, so you can make it larger and you have a stronger result in the end. And using this remark, you can make K grow a bit, V reduce a bit, and omega enlarge a bit. Then you can make everything smooth. And it's not very complicated to see. Actually, you can introduce, a smooth function phi that is non-negative, and such that its zero level is exactly K. So it's standard to construct such a solution. This is a general result by Whitney. And then you want to take K a bit larger but smooth. You will take K of this form. Epsilon K is very small, so K tilde will be close to K. But this epsilon K will be a regular value of phi. And you know that you can have regular values of phi as small as you want. This is a consequence of Sartre's theorem. Okay, so you take this for K. In the same way, you take something like that for V, the place where the function is defined on the beginning. You take epsilon V that is very small, but larger than epsilon k, and that is regular. And if you do that, and then, well, you manage omega in the end, if you do that, you are in a situation where everything in your geometry is smooth. That is, well, it's the boundaries of all the sets that you have here are smooth manifolds. And you can even have an intermediate open set in between if you want. It's not a problem. Just take another regular value of phi. Okay, and then, well, it's not very complicated. So you start from U that satisfies Stokes in V, and you want to approximate it on K by something that is defined on omega. So the first thing is that, well, you just define a U hat by this formula. So P tilde, just the P that you have defined on the beginning, but that you extend in a smooth way to some, smooth compactly supported function outside of V, and you define this U hat. And this U hat, with respect to the original U, it has the same curl. Okay, it's trivial from this formula. And this U hat has this advantage that it is harmonic. Just an easy computation. So if it is harmonic, you can apply Wolff's theorem to it. So you approximate your U hat by a harmonic function. So this, you call this U tilde. And well, you have this thing that U tilde approximates well U hat. And U hat has the same curl as U, so your U tilde approximates well U in the curl sense, only its curl. You have also the fact that the circulations of the two are close, which is useful when there is topology in your domain. Okay. So now you start from this. So there is this function from which you start, and this approximation that you obtain by Walsh, and you have that the difference of the curl is small. So if the difference of the curl was exactly zero, you would have that the difference of the two functions would be a gradient, except that if your domain has some topology, you do not have the fact that a curl-free vector field is a gradient, but it is a gradient up to some finite dimensional space, which is the first Durham cohomology space. Okay, this is the difference between exact and closed one forms. It's the difference between curl-free vector fields and gradient fields. Okay, so but it's not exactly zero, but it's of size capital O of epsilon, and you can deduce in the same way that this decomposition is true up to an error of epsilon. And it happens that in this case, you can even prove that this h is small. So in fact, u is equal to u tilde plus a gradient up to an error of epsilon. So you may think that you are almost done, because when you have this u tilde plus gradient theta, so it is a good approximation of u, and it satisfies this. So Laplacian u tilde is equal to some gradient. But the problem is, you have not taken care of the divergence. So it's this equation is okay, but the divergence of u tilde, it comes from the divergence of u hat or something like that. There is no reason why it should be close to zero. So you have to make a correction to that to take care of the divergence. Okay, so for that, there are two things. Okay, you have this u tilde plus nabla theta, which is a good approximation of u on your compact set, but does not satisfy the divergence constraint. And you can construct a field that has the same divergence as this, that is of order capital O of epsilon, but which is not a good approximation of u. And well, it just happens that when you make the difference and you approximate the difference again by Walsh's theorem, you end up with, you can construct a function that satisfies both conditions. It is at the same time, it has a good divergence, and well, it is close to the original function on the compact. So you only have to explain more or less how you construct this vector field U. So vector field U, its constraint is to have the same divergence of U tilde plus this on the compact set and to stay of a small size. And more or less, okay, it's the same kind of arguments as before. You start from this, so the divergence is small on nu zero. You can deduce, so if it was exactly equal to zero, a divergence vector field would be almost a kernel, because here there is a difference between the functions that are divergence-free and the functions that can be put in curl form, which is a second Durham cohomology space. But since everything is regular here, it is only finite dimensional space, and you can manage that. But assuming that that starting from this small divergence, you can have, oh, this should be a plus here. You have that this is a curl plus some member of the second Durham cohomology space plus an error R, which is of size epsilon. You just extend R in such a way that it stays of size epsilon, and more or less it's done. So, okay, so the details are not important here, but what is strange is that, in fact, you obtain a result of approximation for the Stokes equation, relying on what is already known for a very long time for the harmonic functions. Well, you have to deal a bit with topology and so on, but it's not so complicated, actually. Okay. So now let me finish by giving you ideas on how you can go from this approximation result for the Stokes equation to the result of Lagrangian controllability. So I recall you, what you want is that you have some gamma zero, some gamma one, and you want to find a time-dependent function u that satisfies for all time the Stokes equation, the stationary Stokes equation, and satisfies the boundary constraint, and such that the flow drives gamma zero to gamma one in time t. So as it is a stationary equation, actually, the controllability time t plays absolutely no role. It can be one from the beginning because, well, this is just a question of reparametrizing the solution with respect to time. It is not an evolution equation, so there is absolutely no problem. So we can take capital T equal to one from now on. And actually, the proof mimics a lot what we did for the Euler equation. So there are two parts. First, you want to find a vector field that goes from gamma zero, that drives gamma zero to gamma one, let's say in time one. And you want this vector field to be divergence-free, to be solenoidal. But you do not ask that it satisfies Stokes' equation. Just that it is solenoidal. So you have gamma zero, you have gamma one, then close the same areas, they are homotopic, and you want to be able to go from one to the other. And the second part is to say, now that I have this vector field driving gamma zero to gamma one, I want to approximate the effect of this vector field by a vector field that satisfies Stokes' equation for all time. And this is where our Runge-Walsh type theorem is applied, on the second part. So let's talk about the first part. So the proposition is the following. So you have two smooth Jordan curves or surface, depending on the dimension, which are isotopic in omega. So isotopic is almost the same as homotopic. But what you ask is that you have a continuous function that drives gamma zero to gamma one, and for all intermediate state, this is a diffeomorphism of gamma zero. Okay, you can transform gamma zero by a continuous family of diffeomorphism to gamma one. So it just happens that in dimension two, this is equivalent to be homotopic. This is a result by Epstein. But in dimension for the surfaces, we don't know. Perhaps it's true. We have not seen in the literature something that says that. So we put the correct assumption, which is isotopic. There is no O here. Okay. So, well, you have these two curves. You can deform one smoothly to the other, and they have the same, they enclose the same area. Then you know that you can deform one onto the other by by keeping the diffeomorphism area preserving for all time. You know, you start from this family of diffeomorphism that preserve area only at the beginning and at the end, and only for gamma 0 and gamma 1, and you want something that preserves area or volume for all time. So when we started with that, we started with the 2D Euler equation, and we found a way to prove this by you know, making this sort of movement. You have two, you have gamma 0 and gamma 1 that cut, that are intersecting, and you put parts of gamma 0 toward the corresponding part of gamma 1, and parts of gamma 1 toward the corresponding part of gamma 0. And if you do that at the correct speed, if you rule all the speed exactly and you regularize a bit what happens here, you can prove the statement that was here before. In dimension 2, it's elementary because, well, the geometry is simple. And then, when we worked with Thierry about Euler in 3D, we just discovered that actually it was in the Russian literature for quite a long time. It is actually a result by Krygin that proves the following general result. And well, this result is more or less what I expected in the previous statement, and this is this one. So you consider, let's say, contractible Jordan surfaces, but it could be isotopic Jordan surfaces, it's okay. And you consider a smooth family of embeddings, which is exactly an isotopy, in fact, such that you deform the interior of W to the interior of F1 of W, and at the end, the two parts have the same volume. Well, if you have that, you can transform W into F1 in W in such a way that for all time the volume is preserved by the diffeomorphism, and it is a diffeomorphism of the large manifold. So in our case, we are in capital omega. We can find a deformation of omega that drives gamma 0 to gamma 1 and that preserves the volume for each time. Okay, so I won't explain in details how Krygin's proof work, but just to say it is a consequence of a very famous result by Moser on the deformation of volume forms. Actually, Moser proves that you can deform one volume form to another one, provided that they have the same total mass. And Krygin uses this theorem by Moser to transform the original family FT that he has here in such a way that you can construct a volume-preserving family. So it's not so complicated because, well, you use this result of Moser, which is a very powerful one. So actually, well, if we had known Krygin's theorem earlier, well, the part one is it's already done. You can find a divergence-free vector field that drives gamma zero to gamma one, in the framework of our assumptions. Okay, so the part where we have to work is the second part. You have this vector field that is solenoidal that drives gamma zero to gamma one. But this vector field does not satisfy Stokes' equation. It just satisfies the divergence-free criterion. So our second part, which is a complement of the first one, is to say, okay, we have this vector field X, which is smooth. I mean, well, the regularity in time has no importance. So this vector field is smooth. It is solenoidal. Without loss of generality, it is equal to zero on the outer boundary because, well, what happens on the outer boundary is very far away from gamma zero, so you can modify the vector field here as you want in order to obtain zero boundary condition. And then, well, what this proposition says is that you can approximate the flow of X, of this model flow, by the flow of the solution of Stokes' equation. Okay, so this is exactly the complement of part one. Part one tells you there exists X that does what you want, and now you want to mimic what does X. Okay, so the idea is simple, actually. Mm-hmm. So you have your capital omega, which is your large set. And let's say you have sigma here, and this is capital omega. And you have your gamma zero here. And you want to mimic what happens on gamma zero by something that is defined globally. So what you would like to introduce in the beginning is something, is a solution of Stokes inside gamma zero with exactly the conditions given by X. So X is something that you already constructed, and you define inside gamma zero, or more generally inside gamma of T being the image of gamma zero by the flow of X. And you can define inside the solution of the Stokes equation. The Stokes equation is well posed, it's an elliptic equation. So you can define this U in a unique manner. And what remains now to do is just to extend this in omega, in such a way that it satisfies the boundary conditions here. So, well, what you could have in mind is to say, okay, I have a neighborhood of this. On this, I put zero. On this, I put this U. And if I have a globally defined approximation, then of this, well, it satisfies almost the correct boundary conditions. I only have a small corrections to make. And it satisfies almost, it is almost the correct vector field here, so it is okay. But well, there is a difficulty here that is due to the fact that what we have for our theorem is not Mergelian's theorem. We do not use something, we do not have the fact that we can approximate solutions that satisfy the equation inside your compact. We have a kind of Walsh theorem. So actually, we need something to be defined in the neighborhood of gamma zero. So, well, mainly this is this technical problem that we solve by cutting the proof in several parts. Okay, so well, this slide is mainly what I wanted to say. Okay, so you have a function that is defined. It is not defined on the neighborhood, so it's not clear how you apply this Walsh-type theorem. And there is another remark, is that actually the Walsh-type theorem that we proved is a bit stronger than what we need. Actually, we could have proved this result, and this result is way easier to prove, provided that we have strong results due to Fabre and Lebeau. Is that to say, okay, you have gamma Jordan surface in omega, and you consider this set. So these are the restrictions on gamma of solutions of Stokes defined on the whole omega. And that, okay, so HM, okay, so this means that this is zero outside of sigma. And what you prove is that it is dense, and it is just an argument of duality, and you use the unique continuation results of Fabre and Lebeau. So you can obtain a weaker result than Walsh's, and this could be sufficient for applications. But this, well, it just happens that we did not rely on it on this at the beginning. Okay, so To tackle this problem of the fact that we are not defined on the neighborhood of gamma zero and so on, we split the proof in three parts. There are three parts of growing generality. At the beginning, we assume that all the data is analytic. X is analytic, X is the model vector field. Gamma zero, the original Jordan surface or curve, is analytic, and we treat this. And then we remove the assumption on the analyticity of gamma zero, and then we remove the analyticity on X. Okay, so the first step, when everything is analytic, why it is useful that everything is analytic? When everything is analytic, you can extend the solution of Stokes across the boundary. It is a kind of well, it is an analytic equation. When the curve is analytic and the vector field is analytic, you can extend it across the boundary. It is a Cauchy-Kovalevskaya type theorem. Okay. Okay. So if you can extend it on the boundary, well, you apply Runge-Walsh on these pictures, you have a kind of argument of compactness in time. I won't go into the details, but if you do that, you are okay. You can solve. You can have your approximation of your flow. Okay. It's a perfect case when everything is analytic. And then the second case is where x is still analytic, but not the curve. And when the curve is not analytic, you rely on a famous result by Whitney, which tells you that that gamma zero is perhaps not analytic, but it can be approximated from the outside by analytic curves or surfaces. You applied the step one on these approximations, you control everything, and still in that case, even when gamma zero is not analytic, you can obtain the result. So actually it's a consequence of this result by Whitney. And step three, when everything is only seen finite but not analytic, it's again a consequence of a theorem of Whitney. It is a consequence of Whitney's analytic approximation theorem telling you that if x is only seen finite, you can approximate it by analytic vector fields. So there are Grandval estimates inside, there are stuff that you must control, but still, by relying on this Whitney theorem, you can again be reduced to the second case. So now to conclude, I will just tell you that there are many open problems in the field. Actually, it is a new type of questions. There are many models that can be considered for these questions of Lagrangian controllability. So, well, most of the questions remain open, starting with what I presented at the beginning, the Lagrangian controllability for the actual Navier-Stokes equation. Completely open, we have no idea how to do it. Even with Navier's boundary conditions, where we could try to rely on the Euler equation, completely open. Even for the evolution Stokes equation, we have no idea how it happens. And then we could have equivalent problem of stabilization. Something is completely open. So there are many, many open questions in the fields, and we believe that there's still a lot of work to do. So maybe I should stop here, and thank you for your attention.